Hello to everyone. Thank you for the invitation. This is not the type of audience that I'm used to lecture to, and by the type of data that I'll show you, you'll understand why. But I'm becoming more and more invited to such conferences, which means that maybe this data is becoming more relevant to the people that sit here. I'll talk about measuring, modeling, and analyzing healthcare systems with the emphasis on systems. And the scope will span small measurements through big data all the way to mathematical models, which is actually what I'm doing for a living, developing these models. All of the data that you'll see is processed at the Technion SEE Lab, and I'll tell you a little more about that later. What do I mean by a system? What you see here is a healthcare system. It happens to be a large hospital, and the person who was generous enough to allow us to show this data is sitting here, so this is an opportunity to say thank you to the Rambam Hospital and to its manager. This is the hospital in January 2005, and this is the emergency department. This is real time. And those circles that run within the system are actual patients. So there is no simulation here. It's just playing the data for you. And if you want to look at it a little more closely, then you will see that this is the internal ward. And there are four ways of exiting the system, either by being released or by disappearing, leaving without being seen, for example, or being transferred somewhere else. And unfortunately, the red circle is death. And this is January, and the population is such that this arc is unfortunately highly occupied. So this is what the systems that we look at look like from our points of view. Okay. The research program I've been working on has spanned for the last 15 years or so. And so you see all my partners, first and foremost, my students. I'm collaborating on theory with many people on empirical and statistical analysis with industry. And then there is the research lab. I cannot go into acknowledging each one of them separately. I'll mention one or two as I go along. But all these have actually, as I said, contributed significantly. Without them, this wouldn't have happened. These are my research goals. The reality I operate within is the reality of service systems. Typically, examples are hospitals or call centers, and I'll show you those two examples later. The models that I develop, let me call them in broad terms, serve nets or service networks. And these are mathematical models, so by necessity, they're simple models of these complex realities that they arise from. Here are some names for these models, and I'm not going to elaborate on them, but maybe some who know the theory behind it will recognize it. Queuing networks, fluid networks, diffusion networks, simulation networks. These all come from the world of operations research, but there are many other worlds that offer models that are appropriate for the type of things that we do. The research is developing models which are based on data, analyze them, and then optimize the model, and hopefully be able also to optimize the system from where the model originates. And my goals, I would like my research, first of all, to be reproducible by others so they can check it and see if what I did is right and appreciate it or not. And I would like it to be useful, and I want, like my research and teaching at my advanced academic age, that's a reasonable goal, to also have impact in practice. So this leads immediately to the following two points. The data and the analysis of service networks must be accessible and it must be useful. And the creation and the validation of the models must be easy. It must be hopefully automatic, occur in real time, and be based on the real systems or on real data. And that's a tall order, as I can explain in the following way. So take, for example, an emergency department. I create models, I'm able to analyze them, but I want to be able to generate these models for specific emergency department on demand and automatically. This will allow me, for example, to control in real time patient flow or control bottlenecks. it will allow me in the short time to generate predictions, for example, of how many doctors are needed. So on Monday, based on all the data up to Monday, I should be able to predict how many doctors will be required on Tuesday. And I should be able maybe to redesign the emergency department, for example, to redesign the physician's protocol, changing it, for example, from the way most places are managing it today, where, change physician protocols, let me explain it this way. There are two types of patients within the emergency department. Those that are close to the entry door and those that are close to the exit door. Those that are close to the entry door, you don't know much about. Those that are close to the exit door, you know a lot about, and you would like to free them out so that you can have this room available for others. And when a doctor becomes idle, who should they pick? So this is the classical trade-off between exploration and exploitation. And so I would like to be able to design an algorithm that helps the doctor control patient flow within the emergency department. So by being able to develop my models on demand easily and automatically, I should be able to test my models against reality and then recommend or not recommend their outcome. So this, as I said, is a tall order, and I have some good reasons to be optimistic. Most of it is based on what we do here at the Technion, and this is the SEE Lab. The C stands for Service Enterprise Engineering. This is a laboratory, which I said is the source of all the data that I'm talking about. And traditionally, what we have been doing in operations research and in related discipline is to develop operational recipes. For example, control, staffing, or design, as I described above, and doing it via math models. What I would like to do that is new is to be able to create automatically virtual realities of these emergency departments. And I would like to mine the processes so that I can validate my theoretical models against these virtual realities. And this is quite important for various reasons that I'll just mention briefly. But let me just give you an example of such a reality. It's not a virtual reality, it's an actual reality. Okay, this is, I don't have emergency department data from the previous hospital, so I had to go far away to the Far East to fetch emergency department data. And what you see here is patients flowing within the emergency department. Again, this is real data in October 2012. Each such circle is a patient. This is when they enter. This is when they go through the triage. And this is when the doctor sees them. And here there are some treatments before the first time the doctor sees them. And as you can see, let me just accelerate this by a little. This is a juncture. This is a point where patients fork. Note this blue patient, for example. Oop, I stopped it. You see the blue patient forked into three sub-patients, let us call it, or three tasks. One of them is lab testing, one of them is medication, and one of them is treatment. And so this patient now becomes three entities flowing within my system. So this is a fork node. And these forked tasks will join when I continue, so that later, when the doctor sees them in order to release them, they will join. So you see, this one is a bottleneck, and this one has been the slowest to go out. Okay, so this is, as you can see, I can just look at more busy hours. So it becomes quite crowded. This is the emergency department. This is the reality that I work within. Now, it also allows me to show you that the data is incomplete. Because if this is the triage, and this is the first time that the doctor sees a patient, then obviously there was a time that the triage ended, and there was a time where the patient waited for the doctor. Queuing time. Where is this queuing time? I don't have it here. Where is the queuing time? I don't have it here. The data lacked this piece of information. So hospital data typically is incomplete, in addition to being quite corrupted, and we have to clean it and do lots of effort in order to bring it to a shape that I can actually show it to you this way. Okay, let's continue. So having these animations or these virtual realities is important when one comes from my area of mathematical models, because this will allow me to overcome what I call here the curse of simplicity, in analogy to the opposite curse of complexity or dimensionality. Because oftentimes it is claimed that my models are simply too simple to be credible. And so by looking at real data and by looking at these virtual realities, I can enrich them if desired or if needed, and I can actually allow myself to be scrutinized like it's done in clinical trials. So having a simulator, every sample path of this simulator will correspond to a patient on which you do a clinical trial. And by collecting enough data over the patients that go through the system, I shall be able to trust my models to a level that I can actually recommend their conclusions to managers of hospitals and managers of healthcare systems. Okay, so this is one important use of these models. Okay, the content of my lecture, if I had 1 hour, and that's useful to tell you because then you'll know what other things we are doing. There is this database paradigm that is prevalent in the world that I come from, which is operations research, industrial engineering, and operations management. I don't have time to tell you how I would like to change it. I could have told you about two success stories, which are simple models. I'll actually tell you about half a success story, which has to do with an emergency department during a mass casualty event. And then, if time is left, I shall go through some empirical adventures that show you the type of things that we discover when we do exploratory data analysis at the laboratory at the Technion. So this is a real, this is the reality of emergency departments which I depicted before through a flowchart or a process map. We analyzed such worlds in two scenarios. One, which is a normal scenario. In emergency departments are never under normal steady state conditions, but there are normal times and there are special times, such as mass casualty events. And here is one mass casualty event that took place at Rambam not that long ago. And what we did there, we wired patients and medical staff with RFID tags so that you can track their location continuously. And then we tried to see if we can develop models that will help manage those mass casualty events in real time. In particular, there are about 15 to 20 people running and feeding the computer's data. And we tried to do is to prove that by having these tags on automating the data collection will help monitor or control the event much better. This is the model of the emergency department. This is as simple as it gets. Here are the doctors that we want to focus on, and here is the rest of the world, all aggregated into a single node. Here is my model of the emergency department, simply two ordinary differential equations that actually describe the dynamics of the emergency department during those 2 hours. Nothing more than that. This is work that was done with Galit Yom Tov, who is sitting right over there, and who happens to be Elad Yom Tov's wife that was lecturing before me. Anyway, this is the data that was taken from the event. Cumulative arrivals, cumulative departures. Vertical distance here is how many patients actually were on premise, in this case, in the dining room during the event. This is, the red is the real data, and the blue is my model, the differential equations. And you can see that the blue matches the red quite well. So it matches what I see. It can also predict what I don't see. What you see below is how many doctors are actually busy taking care of patients. And that's something that is more difficult to track. So my models allow me to actually infer things that I can see and maybe predict things that will happen later on. So this is one success story. I want to show you a few examples from call centers, and let me just say an introductory word to this world because this is a healthcare conference. I find it oftentimes very difficult to convince doctors and hospital managers about the relevance of call centers to their world. But based on my experience, they are highly relevant. And the best way I found to convince those people who come from the healthcare industry that they are relevant is that I recommend that they treat call centers as the fruit flies of hospitals. Because things in call centers happen fast. Nobody dies by getting a phone service. You don't need to submit any IRBs in order to approve your research. And the reality is quite relevant. We understand better patients who leave without being seen. We can do flow control. We can design staffing procedures. And most importantly, the data in call centers, even though it's oftentimes corrupted, can be rather complete. So let me show you an example of a call center. Let me show you what I mean by complete data, and by that project on what we can do as hospitals. So just a minute. Okay, this is a call center. What you see here is the answering machine. What you see here is the queues where the customers are waiting. And what you see here is where the agents are actually providing service. And these things that increase here, let me pause it. These things that increase here are the counts. There are 15 customers now in the answering machine. There are 16 customers now waiting in queue. And there are 7 agents of this type providing service. So you can actually track exactly the evolution of the system quite accurately in resolutions of seconds. And believe me, I can do the same thing for the agents of the call centers. I know exactly from an operational point of view what happens to everybody within that system. Okay, we can actually analyze the structure of the system, which is important to understand its dynamics. This is another call center, and maybe those of you who have not been to a call center would not cannot appreciate the complexity that goes into running this operation. These are the queues, these are the pools of the agents, and this topology shows you who can do what. It's a very, very complex system. And this system has to run in real time, and we must match customer needs with server skills and doing it, for example, to 10,000 customers per hour. Allow me to pause for a commercial. I don't have much time. All this data is taken from the Technion SEE Lab. This is the Technion logo. The Technion logo has a cogwheel. 6 years ago when we opened the lab, this was our logo. My students tell me now that it's obsolete. They ask me, what is this? I'll have to design a new one. And this is the full logo of our laboratory. We have lots of data that is at the disposal of the research community. It started about 10 years ago. And let me show you just what, just give you two examples. One example is an Israeli bank that is archiving their call center data at night. And in the morning, I have their data in my laboratory. And I can analyze it, and they can analyze it using the tools that we develop. Another set of data that we are now only getting is data from a large hospital. And this is, again, RFID tracking data, just to show you, you can appreciate the magnitude of it. There are 250,000 events taking place every day. There are 1,000 patients that are being tracked, 350 doctors, and there are 900 readers spread over many, many, many floors, tracked in resolutions of 3 seconds. And all this is arriving to my lab so I can actually analyze it and create those things that you saw before, hopefully in real time. The yellow here are open and free for research and teaching. Everybody can actually get access to it through my lab. A couple of examples, detailed examples, and I'm completing. So let me, I need to show you what I want to show. So I'll just try to convince you that data tells you stories that are worth looking at. That's something that you obviously know. But actually, there is a science in actually looking only at the looking at the data. So what you see here are arrival rates to a call center. This is the first one we ever analyzed. This is an average of 700 help desks in the United States. This is a call center in 1959. That's not a typo. There were call centers in 1959. And this is an arrival rate to an emergency department, which doesn't look much different. So there are two peaks here, at 10 o'clock and at 3 o'clock. The peak here is at 7 o'clock. This is arrival rates to a call center in that hospital that I showed you in the Far East. This is in Korea. And this is an arrival rate to another call center. Again, the shapes are quite similar for reasons that we don't understand. This is a histogram of how long it takes to provide service on a phone. When you take the log of the service time, it becomes perfectly normal, almost perfectly normal. Service times are abnormal. We don't understand why. It's a wonderful mystery. Durations of length of stay in an internal ward are also log normal for the same mysterious reason. We don't understand why. We can measure impatience of customers, how long they're willing to wait. And then we project from these research to how long patients are willing to wait in their emergency department before they leave without being seen. That's a challenge when you do it statistically. And we can actually infer protocols, looking at the data and understanding what goes on in the system, and I don't have time to show you that. So just to conclude, operational data of the type that we're playing with or trying to do research with is quite challenging. It's not there for us to collect like a lot of the data that was lectured on here. So it's a challenge to get it. It's oftentimes, typically it's incomplete, and it's often corrupt. I would like to integrate it with the full path of care, and that's an additional challenge. So I must go beyond the prevalent paradigm in the world of operations research, industrial engineering, and operations management, where there's a single researcher with a single PhD student, or maybe two, obtaining a small data set for a single research project. It doesn't work this way. It's unprofessional. There's no learning across generations. There's no sharing among researchers, and the research is not reproducible. So we must change this paradigm. And research labs, like the one that we have developed in industrial engineering, is a model that has proved successful to overcome these challenges. So data-based research is tradition in physics, chemistry, biology, and other places. Why shouldn't it be also become a tradition in the world that I come from, which is operations research of service systems? Thank you for your patience.